Oh, I'm John Heilemann.
And I'm Mark Halperin. With all due respect to Donald Trump, if you're puzzled by the deal between Ted Cruz and John Kasich, may we suggest a little light reading? Make a deal. Everyone's talking about this genuine, bona fide, 100% electrifying, one-of-a-kind deal. That's right, folks. Ted Cruz and John Kasich have hashed out a rare bargain to help each other try to stop Donald J. Trump, billionaire, from the Republican nomination. Like a lot of high-profile hookups, this one was announced late on a Sunday night when the political markets were closed. Kasich says he's going to stay out of Cruz's way in Indiana, which votes next week, while Cruz will steer clear of down-the-road contests in New Mexico and Oregon. It's being called an agreement, an alliance, a partnership, a pact, a treaty by some, although today in Warwick, Rhode Island, a certain someone used a different word for it.
It's collusion.
Have to collude.
If you collude or if you collude in politics, you're allowed to collude. So they colluded, and actually I was happy because it shows how weak they are. It shows how pathetic they are.
This morning, as Kasich campaigned in Philadelphia, Cruz was stumping in Borden, Indiana, the new bedfellows fielded questions about their arrangement and defended their unorthodox cooperation.
I don't see this as any big deal, other than the fact that I'm not going to spend resources in Indiana, he's not going to spend them in other places. So what? What's the big deal?
So who should your supporters vote for in Indiana?
Well, I've never told them not to vote for me. They ought to vote for me. But I'm not over there campaigning and spending resources. We have limited resources.
We're focusing our energy on the state of Indiana, and Governor Kasich is focusing his energies elsewhere. I think that is a decision, an allocation of resources that makes a lot of sense, and it's devoted to the principle of beating Hillary Clinton in November and turning this country around. I don't doubt that Donald Trump is going to scream and yell and curse and insult and probably cry and whine some as well. That has been Donald's pattern.
John, what is behind this extraordinary Cruz-Kasich deal, and is it a good idea for the Stop Trumpers?
Well, it is. A wise man has been saying on television all day long that it's a desperate deal but a necessary deal. That wise man is you, and I agree with that, and I have to give pride. I mean, it's just obviously true. You know, they wouldn't be doing this if they didn't have to, although I have been saying for months, literally for months, or at least for weeks, that they should start doing stuff like this. And that not, I didn't really think about it in terms of these particular combination of states, but in California, where the districts are in play, both of these guys, Ted Cruz has plenty of money, John Kasich does not, but Donald Trump is not on a glide path. He's got an achievable but difficult goal to get to 1237. Every delegate counts, and for those guys to not be strategic would be stupid.
He's going to do very well in the Northeast tomorrow. Indiana is extraordinarily important. It was identified early on by all the campaigns as a state that could make or break Trump's chances of getting to a majority. Anything that increases the chances of stopping Trump from winning Indiana is a good deal for the Stop Trumpers.
Right, and Cruz is the only one with a chance to win.
Cruz is the only one who could beat him. Kasich's got a lot of support in Indiana. Right. And the question to me now is, can the groups come in and create an environment where Cruz can stop Trump? Cruz has to do it. The outside groups will be important, but Cruz now has to take this opportunity, not a clean one-on-one, but a cleaner one-on-one, to try to make the case of why Indiana Republicans and those voting in the open primary should vote for Cruz and not Trump.
People are making a big deal out of Kasich saying, you know, my voters should still vote for me. People should still vote for me. It really is irrelevant. The people who are going to vote for Kasich are still going to vote for Kasich, and Kasich would be crazy to tell them to switch their votes because they're not going to go vote for Ted Cruz. The real question here is, within this primary system, the undecided voters right now, where are they going to go? Those people can be persuaded to make a strategic vote, maybe, and certainly media, dollars being spent, as you suggested. Where does our principal's PAC spend money? Where do others spend money? That could make the difference in a very close race. Hold down Kasich's number a little bit, push Cruz's up a little bit, could be the margin of difference.
Cruz people believe they can get some Kasich people if they can peel off at least a few.
I'm always saying that I don't think, I think the Kasich's point, I know the bell went off, but the Kasich saying, I'm not going to tell my voters not to vote for me, of course, he'd be a crazy candidate to say something else, is all I'm saying. Okay. Now, if you believe, like Donald Trump does, that Ted Cruz and John Kasich are colluding, then that fits pretty neatly into the story that the Donald's been pushing more broadly about the Republican nomination contest, that it's a rigged deal, it's a crooked deal, it's rotten to the core. And there are more graphs to add to that Trump story. This weekend, Ted Cruz out-hustled Trump for delegates again, this time at the state convention in Maine. The Trump campaign announced that the frontrunner will campaign in Indiana tomorrow with legendary basketball coach Bobby Knight. Mark, how do you think that the Cruz-Kasich deal, beyond amplifying Trump's rigged deal rhetoric, beyond that, strategy and tactics, how will this affect the way that Trump campaigns for the next 6 weeks?
Well, he needs to win Indiana now, and he needs to think about taking on Cruz directly there. Today he was hitting Kasich a lot and continues to hit Kasich, but I think he'll need to figure out how to engage in a one-on-one contest with Cruz without getting too drawn in, because part of what's benefited Trump is staying above the fray. The other thing I think he needs to think about is after tomorrow night, does he need to shake things up? Trump hasn't changed very much. Does he need to shake things up to get to the majority, or is he after tomorrow night on a path to do that?
Right. I mean, look, you know, I think it's pretty clear for the reasons that we said in the first question that's been this block that, you know, Ted Cruz is going to live in Indiana. He's made it pretty clear he's going to do that, going to go there and, you know, camp out in that state. It seems to me that, again, for all these reasons, if Trump can win Indiana even after this deal has been cut, that he can triumph in that way, it will amplify the effect that Indiana was going to have anyway if he won it. He'll be able to say, yeah, these guys colluded against me and I still beat him in Indiana. Yeah. And it just makes it really clear he must spend money there. He must be on the air there. He must be on the ground there. It's crucial for him to be able to pull that state off, because if he does, he can probably drive a stake in the heart of this whole thing.
Yeah, he also needs, I think, to figure out how to appeal to the kind of moderate Republicans in the Indianapolis area where Kasich has been strongest and still will be strongest. Those are the kind of Republicans he needs to unify the party. So a big win in Indiana with the right demographic support would, I think, really help Trump. The other thing that's going on right now is Trump continues to not do well, as you said, in winning these after action, after the primaries and caucuses. You know, the Trump people now are pretty much all in, first ballot or bust. Right. And I think one of the things Trump needs to consider if he doesn't do well in Indiana is, do they need to broaden out that strategy? Do they have any chance of protecting their flank on a second ballot win? I don't think so. And that makes winning Indiana all the much more important.
I mean, I think, you know, one of the interesting things to see in Indiana, this is a state that is not that different from Illinois, a state that Donald Trump won. It's not that different from other Midwestern states where Trump has done well. Michigan, for instance, just the demographics of the state. You know, this bathroom issue in North Carolina, that's the kind of issue where among relatively moderate suburbanite and urbanite Indianapolis Republicans, they might be more attracted to Donald Trump than they would be to Ted Cruz. And Cruz is going all in on that issue and trying to win basically by taking all the rural voters from Indiana and winning there.
Bobby Knight's a big endorsement. Look for Trump to potentially pick up some other sports-related Indiana endorsements in a sports-mad state. Look to see if he can get any political endorsements in that state. That'd be a big deal if he can start creating that bandwagon effect, which so far he has not. All right. Let's talk a little bit more about Indiana specifically. It's winner take all by congressional district. All you need is a plurality there to win all the delegates, not a majority. But it's also an open primary, which works to Trump's advantage typically. Even if Trump's rivals concede that he's going to do very well in the five northeastern states voting tomorrow, likely picking up around or more than 100 delegates, Indiana's only got 57. But it has a lot of momentum associated with it. According to the latest CBS News online tracking poll, Trump leads in the state now with 40%. Cruz has 35%. That's within the margin of error, and clearly Cruz is with striking distance. Kasich has 20 in that poll, although polls better in some of the big congressional districts. John, how big are the stakes if Trump, despite this new alliance, wins Indiana? You alluded to it before. Does that end this contest?
Well, it doesn't end it, but it really, I mean, you know, if Trump, having won in New York, having it big in New York, huge. If he has a big, huge night tomorrow night, as we suspect, and then he goes to Indiana and he wins there, takes the popular vote and takes the most delegates. The question that we've been asking ever since New York, does the momentum from New York and the Northeast carry? It will start to look like it does. And you know, and I'll say it just, you know, I think it's, again, the psychology is very, very important. Even more than the delegates, the psychology are very important. The stakes are big.
Part of why it was so vital from the Cruz point of view to get Kasich out and why he was willing to give up those other two Western states is the Indianapolis media market. Seven of the state's congressional districts of the 10 are touched by the Indianapolis media market. It's the kind of place where you've got people who support people like Mitch Daniels when he was governor, more moderate Republicans, the kind of Republicans that Ted Cruz has not been able to win in any significant numbers in the Northeast. If Cruz can make inroads there, great for him. If he can't, and Trump dominates those congressional districts and should do well in the rural ones, he could win big in Indiana. It's up to Cruz. I won't say the entire Stop Trump movement is now in Ted Cruz's back in Indiana, but pretty close to it, not just for the symbolism, not just for the delegates, but they're running out of real estate.
Yeah, well, that's the key. The delegates and the real estate are related.
Cruz has to beat him somewhere.
He does. And look, I mean, it's been a long time. You know, so, I mean, Cruz, obviously, he won Wisconsin, you know, so that's not that long ago, but it feels like a long time in terms of the weeks that have passed. You look at that polling, a lot of people believe that Trump's ceiling is right around where the polling suggests it is now, right around 40. You got the rest of the votes distributed in that tracking poll, leaves only about 5% undecided. So if Cruz picks up a lot of that undecided vote and then picks up a little bit of Kasich, if Kasich collapses because people think he's given up on Indiana, he can just eke it out.
There are two groups who will give up on stopping Trump if Trump wins Indiana. It's a lot of voters and a lot of donors who will not fund an anti-Trump movement that can't stop Trump.
Up next, the art of the steal, the art of the squeal. We'll talk more about that Kasich Cruz pact after these words from our very generous sponsors.
Think big, know your market, and the real excitement is playing the game. That's advice from Donald J. Trump in his second favorite book, The Art of the Deal. Here to talk to us about that new deal that Trump doesn't like all that much, Casey Hunt, MSNBC political correspondent who tracks the Stop Trump movement and was in Baltimore today covering John Kasich, and Kelly O'Donnell, NBC News correspondent who is covering Trump today in Warwick, Rhode Island. Ladies, thank you both for joining us. Casey, we've been talking about the prospect that these outside groups, the Stop Trump Super PAC, the pro-Cruz super PAC, would now be able to devote their resources simply to a virtual one-on-one. What do you know about what those groups now plan for this last week before the Indiana primary?
Well, Mark, I think it's more of a pulling back from defense, if you will. These groups are going to stay on offense in the places where they've kind of agreed that they're going to have this detente. So in Oregon, you're going to see the Kasich forces likely still go up with contrast, with negative ads against Ted Cruz, because they think that that's the most effective way for them to get John Kasich to win in Oregon. Same in Indiana, that the pro-Cruz kind of forces are still going to have that contrast spot against Kasich up. What they're not going to do is be going into places, you know, where they've agreed, okay, John Kasich's going to run in Oregon, New Mexico. You're not going to see the Cruz super PACs going in there to try to shore up numbers. And likewise, you're not going to see the candidates themselves out on the trail. But, you know, for big picture, that's really what this is all about, right? This pact is as much about these outside groups as it is about the candidates. And it's really about these donors, right? These big donors, a lot of them got burned backing Jeb Bush or some other establishment candidate, and they haven't seen any kind of coalescing that makes them feel like, hey, this is an investment worth making. And it was very clear that there was kind of a breaking point approaching where Cruz and Kasich were going to need to do something to reassure these people that if they kept funding these Stop Trump movements, they might actually get somewhere. And so now, of course, it all rests starting in Indiana.
Kelly, Cruz, we've been told, plans to spend most of the next week in Indiana. Any indication how Trump plans to approach the state now that Cruz is trying to get him in a one-on-one contest?
Well, the big headline on that point today is that Trump, when he was here, sort of hinted he hopes he could attract Bobby Knight, the famous basketball coach. And he already had that locked in, because just minutes later, the release comes out and an event with Donald J. Trump and Bobby Knight. So that's one way to do it. For Donald Trump, it really is about the packaging, the branding, and the marketing to such a great degree. To have himself aligned with someone who is popular there, to have the big splash, that's something we'll see in Indiana. It was so notable today as well that Ted Cruz had the opportunity to talk about this deal, and the words he chose were very, very telling. He said, John Kasich has withdrawn from Indiana, allowing us to have a head-to-head. Well, that's really not what this deal was about. Ted Cruz didn't acknowledge that he, too, was going to pull back from the West Coast states, Oregon and Washington, more natural places for John Kasich. So even though the teams got this idea together, they have that strategy Casey was talking about with the funding and the donor class for the Never Trump, Stop Trump, Never Can Be Trump kinds of movements, the two candidates are still the same guys who don't want to cede any ground to the other. And we saw that in the way they were sort of dismissive of this plan today and saying that, of course, they don't want to tell their voters not to support them. So sometimes tactics don't quite meet with the real world of the campaign trail. For Donald Trump, he was in full Trump sort of character today, with facial expressions, hand gestures, lots of sort of voice intonation, taking on both Cruz and Trump, and Kasich repeatedly in sort of mocking tones, also kind of dissecting what he thinks they have not done well in this campaign. But it was the kind of relentless, sort of punchline driven Trump performance meant to tell voters here and those who are watching around the country that he thinks he can take out the last two opponents. Certainly those other forces in the party are worried about that, but Donald Trump did what he has done all along, try to label his opponents and relentlessly pound that in.
So more presidential if he was trying to be president of the Friars Club.
Well, he made a promise today. He said he will stop tweeting if he becomes president, and he sort of shrugged and said, not presidential. So he made a social media promise to sort of back away from his most common form of talking to his voters, supporters, the general public. Yep. So we'll have to watch carefully if his tweet rate changes in the days to come.
All right. So in the discussion of, like, presidential or not presidential behavior, Kasie, today, Donald Trump, in going after John Kasich, mocked his eating habits, his enthusiastic way that Governor Kasich eats. Came up with some nicknames for him. One for 38 Kasich. You talked to John Kasich in Rockville, Maryland, not that long ago, and asked him about what he thought about how Trump talked about him today. Tell us about that.
Governor Kasich was not amused, shall we say. Didn't really have any interest in engaging with or discussing at all his eating habits. Kind of remained, stone-faced. Wouldn't really engage either on the nickname front. You know, there's been some suggestion sometimes, if Donald Trump gives you a nickname, it means you're kind of on the upswing a little bit. So I guess kind of John Kasich's moment in the sun from that perspective, but he wasn't interested in having that either. And, you know, he also didn't want to talk too much. We also talked about how long this pact between the two camps was going to last, because, I mean, it really is an open question, right? They say, okay, we're going to go through Oregon, we're going to go through New Mexico. But the real piece of the map that's so important is California. And figuring out how to split up a state like California is going to take a lot more than just an agreement to kind of, you know, take the hands off in one area or the other. They may have to sit down and carve it up by congressional districts. I have some questions about whether or not the super PACs might start to get together. Obviously, we've seen the campaigns, you know, kind of make overtures to each other. The super PACs could also talk to each other if they decided to take that step. I think the earliest kind of outline seems to be, you know, Bay Area for Kasich, Southern California for Cruz, but there's just so many unanswered questions, and Kasich absolutely refused to commit to having this go beyond anything that's been strictly outlined as of today.
Kasie, we only have about 30 seconds left, but I was really struck by the interview. He seemed a little grumpy cat with you in that interview. I mean, he didn't really want to answer anything. At one point, you said, how long will it go? And he said, well, whatever our teams agreed to. He didn't seem like he was particularly driving a message. He seemed kind of like passive aggressive in the interview. It seemed a little odd to me, the tenor that he took with you. Again, just real quick on that.
Yeah, you know, I was a little bit surprised, too. And in fact, his communications director followed up with me afterwards and said, you know, essentially what they've been messaging on this point, saying this is all about, you know, beating Hillary Clinton and John Kasich is the person to beat Hillary Clinton. But he wasn't ready to make that argument with me. And he's usually, I mean, you guys know, he's usually a pretty good-natured guy on the campaign trail. So I think clearly the way that this has played out seems to be under his skin a little bit today.
Okay, Kasie Hunt, Kelly O'Donnell, on both NBC News. Thank you both so much. Come back, we'll talk to a member of Team Kasich, John Sununu of New Hampshire, about why this deal was struck after a quick break.
Joining us now by phone from Hampton Falls, New Hampshire, the national co-chairman of John Kasich's presidential campaign and the former Granite State Senator, John E. Sununu. Senator Sununu, welcome back to the show. Donald Trump says that Ted Cruz and John Sununu and John Kasich are colluding, and that they're desperate and pathetic. What say you?
Look, Donald Trump is scared. He's not going to have enough delegates at the convention. We're going to an open convention, and he's going to lose 300, maybe 400 delegates on the second ballot. And once he does, he's not going to be the nominee. This is about using resources effectively. And the, look, what was done was very simple. John Kasich isn't going to spend money in Indiana, and the Cruz campaign's not going to spend money in New Mexico or Oregon. And that gives them both a chance to play to their strengths. Equally important, tomorrow John Kasich's going to win delegates in Connecticut, Rhode Island, and Maryland, and Pennsylvania. And every delegate he takes away from Donald Trump makes it harder for Trump to get to 50%.
Senator, can you argue that this was done out of strength as opposed to out of weakness?
From John Kasich's perspective, it was done because it's a good tactical move. He doesn't get the $1 billion in free media that Donald Trump gets. You guys cover Trump all the time. You've given him more free media than anyone in the history of politics. And as part of the Kasich campaign, we're going to spend money in the way that gives us the best chance to win delegates where we know we're strong. And that's what this is about.
Does the Kasich campaign agree that it's the importance that Donald Trump lose in Indiana? Is that important?
I think if he loses in Indiana, and as you pointed out, that he's neck and neck with Ted Cruz at the moment, it makes it just about impossible for him to get to 1237. He's going to have a very hard time as it is, but a loss in Indiana puts it out of reach. And look, in a convention, you're going to have 2,400 Republican delegates. It's an open, fair, transparent system. Everyone knows the rules. And those delegates are going to decide who's got the strength and the vision to lead the party and win in November. And John Kasich is the strongest nominee we could have.
So let me just ask that if Cruz is the likeliest person to beat Trump, and beating Trump is important, why is Governor Kasich today saying that his vote, that people should still vote for him in Indiana?
The point he was making is that this is an agreement about resources. It's simple. It's about where the campaigns are going to spend money. It's not you're trying to make it more complicated. You're trying to, is a cross endorsement? Are they telling people who to vote for or who not to vote for? It's none of that. It's just about where they're going to target their financial resources. Plain and simple.
Senator, less than 30 seconds. Explain how the next month will play out between these three candidates.
Sure. Well, forget about the next month, the next 2 weeks. 2 weeks from now, you'll look at the delegate totals, and it will be clear that Donald Trump is going to have to win 80% of the delegates or some such number to get to 1237. Everyone's going to know and understand we're going to an open convention. 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, people thought Donald Trump was going to be inevitable. Now
right.
They know an open convention is likely. In 2 weeks, it'll be a certainty.
All right, Senator Sununu, thanks a ton. Up next, Hillary Clinton's deep stakes hullabaloo and much more. We'll be right back with all of it. This past weekend, an interview with a conservative billionaire aired on a Sunday show and shocked the nation. And for once, that billionaire was not Donald J. Trump. Charles Koch, the libertarian businessman, spoke to ABC's Jonathan Karl and expressed some concerns about the existing Republican presidential candidates. Is there one that he'd be more comfortable with than those in his party? Take a listen.
But as far as the growth of government, the increase in spending, it was 2.5 times under Bush that it was under Clinton.
So is it possible another Clinton could be better than another Republican
it's
the
possible.
Next time around?
It's possible.
You couldn't see yourself supporting Hillary Clinton, could you?
Well, we would have to believe her actions would be quite different than her rhetoric.
That interview was followed by a front page story in The Wall Street Journal this morning about CEOs recoiling from the anti-Wall Street rhetoric in both parties in this cycle. It says, quote, Mrs. Clinton might appear to be the most business-friendly option given her resume, her close relations to some corporate donors, and her message of delivering pragmatic results, end quote. Also this weekend in The New York Times, Mark Landler, who's going to be on this show shortly, wrote about how, when compared with her potential Republican rivals, Hillary Clinton might draw greater support from military hawks. As I said, we'll have a lot more with Mark Landler later in the show. The GOP still dealing with the possibility that Republican women may defect and vote to elect the first female president in the United States history. So, Mark, A big question going forward for whether it's Donald Trump, Ted Cruz, or anyone else, but especially Donald Trump or Ted Cruz, what can they do, if anything, to deal with the possibility that Hillary Clinton could poach hawks, business people, female leaders? These are all open, big, open, vulnerable spots.
Trump or Cruz is going to have to win the battle of ideas for those elites, because you could easily see a Hillary Clinton press conference, military, retired military officials for Clinton, corporate CEOs for Clinton, small business owners for Clinton, Republican women for Clinton. Donald Trump or Ted Cruz is going to have to come forward with policies that are not only put Clinton on the defensive, but go on the offense with those groups, because it will break the back of the Republican Party if they have widespread defections amongst the grassroots and elites in those categories.
All right, let's be clear on, obviously, with women, she's going to have a leg up for a lot of reasons, policy and her historic candidacy.
You can't have Republican women senators endorsing her.
Right. Well, that's true. Yeah. Right. So she's going to have a leg up in that area. One of the dirty little secrets, or not dirty little secrets, but a little secret of her time on the Senate Armed Services Committee, is that the military likes Hillary Clinton. They think she knows her stuff when it comes to bombs and bullets. The other group, the business leaders, is an interesting question, because, of course, she has run pretty far to the left in this nomination fight with Bernie Sanders. She doesn't have a deficit reduction plan. She hasn't.
And yet,
about
the Wall Street Journal front page story says, right, as you read,
well,
she may be seen as,
yes,
better on trade, better on infrastructure,
better on
immigration, better on a bunch of things.
Business priorities. Yeah. I know.
So you know, look, if you look at Bill Clinton in 1992, endorsed by tons of Republican CEOs,
yes,
you look at Barack Obama in the financial crisis, had tons of business people, including a lot of Republicans, saying he's better than McCain on the economy. Trump and Cruz are going to have to worry. For David Koch to say that,
yes,
is a huge canary in the coal mine.
Huge. And just again, you can't make this point enough times. When a Democrat makes significant inroads in corporate America, into the Pentagon and the military establishment, those are huge problems for Republicans. Those are traditional areas of strength for Republicans, that if a Democrat makes those inroads, they have a huge leg up to getting a general election.
Trump may have some crossover appeal, but right now Hillary Clinton's in a better place to live the dictum. What's mine is mine, and what yours is, we'll negotiate over.
Yeah, right.
All right, speaking of the New York Times, the gray lady published a piece this weekend that, for the first time in a significant way, named some names of potential Hillary Clinton running mates, which the article by our pal Pat Healy said she might choose after the Republicans make their pick for a running mate. Included on the list in the Times, former Massachusetts Governor Deval Patrick, current HUD Secretary Julian Castro, current Labor Secretary Tom Perez, and a whole bunch of current senators, including Elizabeth Warren, Sherrod Brown, Tim Kaine, and a few others. John, this article set off a torrent of deep state speculation. What are the flaws in the things people are currently saying about a potential Clinton running mate?
Well, the core flaw is that although Hillary Clinton is a planner, and although she is, I'm sure, spent some time thinking about this, she is going to be meticulous and she's going to be calculating about this choice. And I don't think that they are going to get serious about this until after they know who the Republican nominee is. And so all of this is wildly premature at this point to be talking in a serious way about this.
The presidential nominee might be picked at the convention. The Republican convention is the week before the Democratic convention. We may see the two vice presidential selections picked within days of each other. To me, the biggest flaw, besides that, is people throw out names. To be picked by Hillary Clinton, you have to be seen as ready to be president,
yes,
by the public and the press. There are people up on this wall right now. Sorry, not all of you are seen as ready to be president. And you have to survive a vet. And I can tell you, without having done a Google search, let alone ask for their tax returns,
yeah,
that there are people on that wall who would not survive a political vet.
A serious vet. I agree with that. And, you know, this is one of the things that, you know, the prisms through which the political press and others speculate about the vice presidency often has to do with demographic groups, with winning a state. This is one area where smart candidates are in alignment with political science, which is you don't win states with vice presidential nominees. You don't win demographics with vice president. What you do is you pass. It's a test of judgment. Did you take this seriously and pick someone who could be your replacement? And if you win that sweepstakes with the press and with the voters, that's all. That's all you need to do.
Nothing else matters. And so be wary of any name that doesn't meet that test, because Hillary Clinton's not going to pick them.
She knows this is where the politics and substance are in alignment. All right.
100%.
Forget about the willy or won't he, about how tough Bernie Sanders is going to be on Hillary Clinton in the coming contests. Bernie Sanders has made it pretty clear that he is not going anywhere. This weekend, he drew thousands, many thousands of supporters at rallies in Providence, Rhode Island, and in New Haven, Connecticut. And today in Hartford, also Connecticut, the nutmeg state, he played up his usual riffs against Clinton regarding her Wall Street speeches. Meanwhile, Hillary Clinton is using this new uplifting ad as her closing argument in those five northeastern states that are going to be voting tomorrow.
We need to make sure he gets a chance to learn how to do that.
Walk it out together now.
America is stronger when we are all supporting one another.
Spread a little hope and love now. Spread a little hope and love now.
So today in Wilmington, Delaware, Clinton talked again about Republicans more than her Democratic rival, kind of in keeping with the theme of unity. So, Mark, as this race goes on, my question for you, beyond nice ads like that about unity, how can Hillary Clinton defang Sanders if that's possible?
Don't push him out of the race. Resign yourself to the fact that he's going on. Try to, when you punch back, as her ruffians do, punch back maybe a little bit softer. Game out the platform committee. Figure out what you can give him in the platform committee. Figure out what night he should speak at the convention. Lavish him with praise. Figure out someone to nominate him at the convention who will lavish him with praise. And personally be nice to him. Have the Clinton to Sanders contact be just smothered in love. And then I think this is not going to be hard.
Bernie Sanders is a guy who has this been an incredible journey for him. But he got into this race for reasons that, and again, they will deny this publicly, but they got into the reasons about trying to change the discussion in America. Yeah. He's been a success on his own terms of why he got in this race. She needs to flatter him in that way. Make clear to him how much
he's changed the discourse and changed the party.
Changed the media.
He's not
a fool. And he's not self-destructive, and he doesn't want to see a Republican elected. There's a lot of common ground here. They just have to realize they've already won. It's time to stop being quite as pugnacious as he needed to be a month ago.
Exactly. And this is a guy who, as you just said, he's far beyond where he thought he would be. Let him enjoy the moment and help him recognize that.
And
have him raise a lot of money for you.
All right, when we come back,
inside the very complex relationship between Hillary Rodham Clinton and Barack Obama, right after this. This morning, President Obama, still on his European trip, announced that he will send an additional 250 U.S. Special Operations Forces to Syria to battle ISIS. This announcement got us thinking about the president's legacy and about Hillary Clinton, who's now trying to succeed her former boss. Our next guest knows a lot about the very complicated Obama-Clinton relationship. Mark Landler is New York Times White House correspondent and the author of the new book, Alter Egos, Hillary Clinton, Barack Obama, and the Twilight Struggle Over American Power. And he joins us now from our Washington Bureau. Mark, thanks for joining us. Congratulations on the book.
Thank you, Mark.
So 7 years into the administration, Hillary Clinton's obviously been out for a while. How would you describe the differences in their relationship today as compared to when she joined the administration about 7 years ago?
Well, you know, for one thing, they know each other well. They know each other's foibles. And I think there's a level of understanding and tolerance that just comes from being so familiar with one another. I mean, it was very kind of distant and formal and mannerly at the beginning. They were like sort of two people, just planets in orbit. Now they know each other well, and I think the president recognizes that for whatever failings she may have from his perspective, he needs her to win this election to secure some of the important parts of his foreign policy legacy, for starters. So there's, I think, a degree of a mutual interest and understanding. I wouldn't go so far as to say they're close friends. I don't think there's much evidence they ever became close friends, certainly not the relationship he developed with Joe Biden, but a level of mutual respect and understanding for sure.
Mark, you point out that they have obviously different ways of looking at the world, and that's a lot of what your book's about, is the difference in their sense of what America's role should be in this world. In what places were they most in conflict in real time, where there were actual arguments between them when she was Secretary of State and he was president?
I think probably the biggest one was Syria, where, if you recall, she advocated forcefully, along with David Petraeus, for aiding the moderate rebels. And President Obama was just extremely reluctant. He finally came around on this after Petraeus was out of his job and Clinton was on her way out of state. But he never embraced it with anywhere near the robust kind of approach that I think Clinton would have favored. And if you go, you know, forward in time, she has been pretty open about saying that some of the decisions that were made in 2012 helped open up the space that the Islamic State swept in and occupied both in Syria and Iraq. So I think that's the brightest line between the two of them. And even today, for that matter, she's on record as favoring a partial no-fly zone. That's a step the president, notwithstanding what he announced in Europe this morning, is in no way ready to take.
They've got some, as you just described, one of them. They've had some tactical disagreements. If you go up to the strategic level and kind of a vision of where America, the role America should be playing in the world today, where do they disagree on that?
Well, I would say in the broadest terms that President Obama has set out to define American interests more narrowly than almost any other post-World War II president. There are things for which this president just doesn't believe the U.S. ought to take major military risks. I mean, one very key example is Ukraine, where the president feels that Ukraine matters a great deal more to Vladimir Putin and the Russians than it does to us, and hence Putin will do much more to make sure that as he retains his influence there. And Hillary Clinton clearly, I think, would have taken a tougher line against Putin in Ukraine. Her friends say that she supported the idea of supplying lethal defensive weapons to the Ukrainian troops. That's something the president has refused to do against the advice of his own defense secretary, among other people. So I think at the grand strategic level, it's a question of how you define American interests and what you're willing to do to defend them. I think the president simply defines them more narrowly than Hillary Clinton does.
She came into the Secretary of State's job with a lot more foreign policy, national security experience and knowledge than he did when he became president of the United States. So, you know, part of the reason why she was appointed was, in theory, that she could bring that to the table. Is there an example that you can think of where she influenced him on a major foreign policy decision?
Yes, there's a very big one, and it has a very mixed legacy. It's the NATO intervention in Libya. She really was the key player in turning the president around and in making him agree to support this, you know, fairly risky intervention, the idea being that they had to avert a potential genocide in Benghazi. I think the president has characterized this as one of the most difficult decisions he's made and one he has deep regrets about. Clearly, the outcome, you know, the aftermath was terrible. It not only led to the country being in chaos, it also spawned indirectly the Benghazi scandal, which engulfed both the president and Clinton, although Clinton in a more lasting way. And she was really the key person. If you go back and look at the email records, which are now all public, you know, her own advisors were saying that this was going to be a cornerstone of a Hillary Clinton doctrine. So they really saw this as what would be a major pillar of a Hillary Clinton foreign policy. I think she's going to run on it a lot more carefully, given how badly things turned out.
All right, Mark Landler, The New York Times. The books, Alter Egos, Hillary Clinton, Barack Obama, and the Twilight Struggle Over American Power. No two more important people in our politics today, and no more important topic than this. And a great read and an important book. Mark, thank you. Congratulations again on the book. We come back, what life is like for one Trump supporter in Connecticut, which votes tomorrow. We'll take you to the Nutmeg State right after this quick break.
Donald J. Trump, billionaire, is expected to win the Connecticut primary tomorrow. It is, of course, a well-known Democratic state. So we sent our filmmaker, resident auteur Griffin Hammond, 135 miles north of here, Gotham City, to a rural, economically depressed area in the eastern part of Connecticut to learn one thing, what it's like being a supporter of Donald Trump in Connecticut these days.
As I can say, what are you hearing? Birds. A nice breeze.
Yeah.
It doesn't get much better than this.
Jeff Fiennes lives in rural eastern Connecticut.
You know, how are we going to retire? What's our quality of life going to be?
It's getting tougher and tougher year after year. It's all about family.
You know, my wife and I, we babysit our grandson 4 to 5 days a week because my son and his wife, they work, you know, those jobs just to try and stay even and get ahead.
The largest town in this area is Windham, population 25,000.
Historically, when you look at the town, it was an old mill town.
The mills moved out, so the population that was here just can't find jobs.
We have pretty high unemployment. I think Eastern Connecticut is still suffering.
Windham County has the lowest income level in Connecticut.
Their costs are going up, but their incomes are not going up.
All right, Griffin, you're a documentary filmmaker. Anything that surprised you about the people in the Windham area so far?
Maybe I'm surprised at how nice everyone is, that they've already been so welcoming, that I'm already speaking on the radio, and I've just been here for minutes.
Donald Trump leads the Republican polls in Connecticut by at least 20 points.
I really think Donald's got, you know, the inside track on jobs, and he knows what needs to be done. We need to wipe the slate clean, go back to the Constitution, and rebuild this country. We've got conservative values. You can see it on our streets. We're quite rural. If you go to Windham, they're not as conservative. They're extremely, I'm going to say, liberal.
I'd probably lean more towards Kasich, to be very honest with you, because I think he's more of a middle line type of guy as such.
Right now, I'm for Bernie. He has actually accomplished things for climate change and has a plan.
She's a policy wonk, and I think that she will do a wonderful, wonderful job, and it's about time.
It doesn't feel like a political battleground.
There are a lot of people that don't like to wear their politics on their sleeve. They definitely are. They're worried about being harassed. One of the things I like about Donald Trump and what first brought me to him was he says what we're thinking. He says it. And I really think that Donald Trump can go down there, shake it up, and bring a revival back to Washington.
Here we are down on my billboard, where I get to tell the rest of the town and perhaps the rest of the state, if they're traveling down Route 66, who I'm interested in.
There are a lot of people that will support me, a lot of people that don't put their sign, won't put the sign in the yard. And honestly, I lose anywhere from 2 to 3 signs a night. Okay, I don't know whether it's the opposition or somebody that just wants a sign to put in their yard.
So there's not that many Republicans in our lifetimes who we can remember who would win the Mississippi primary and are likely to win the Connecticut primary. How is it that Trump, you think, has put himself in a position where his appeal is just basically crosses all of the traditional red state, blue state geographic divides?
I think he struck a chord with a lot of people with a message that does play across different geographical areas and different groups of people who are frustrated with the status quo. And, you know, one of the reasons I like that piece so much is because the media often paints Trump supporters as crazy and unreasonable.
Right.
And like all candidates, he has some supporters who are crazy and unreasonable. But people like that.
Let's acknowledge that.
People like that are as big a part of Trump's coalition as anybody else. And that is a guy who cares about his country, cares about his family, and lives in Connecticut, which, again, you wouldn't think of as Trump country, but a state that he is likely to win resoundingly tomorrow.
It's funny. It's funny that the fact, I mean, look, Donald Trump, if he's the nominee, will not win the state of Connecticut. It is a blue state. But it is interesting that the Republican and the Republican Party of Connecticut, which couldn't be more different than the Republican Party in a lot of other places in the country, Donald Trump is the dominant figure there. The frustration is ecumenical and to a large extent, he's interested. Trump has had a lot of appeal across a lot of different parts of the Republican coalition. All right. Our thanks to Griffin Hammond for illustrating that very point. Coming up, the many lawsuits of Donald Trump at your fingertips. And remember, if you're watching us in Washington, D.C., you can also listen to us on the radio at Bloomberg 99.1 FM. We'll be right back.
Last thing before we go, our colleagues here at Bloomberg put together a BAFO interactive feature about lawsuits that Donald Trump has been involved in over the years. We've been playing with it all day, and we want to tease you out with three numbers from this feature. First, more than 1,300. That's how many times Trump and his companies have either sued or been sued since 2000. Second number is 59. That's how many of the total lawsuits that Trump is publicly known to have settled, about 35%, even though he brags that people don't sue him because he doesn't settle. And finally, the number 42. Trump and his companies have won this many cases in court compared to 19 that he's lost. Again, The feature is interactive, so you can click around and look at all the lawsuits. It's great fun. It's on BloombergPolitics.com. John, riddle me this. What does no man want to have, but no man want to lose? That's from Batman.
Yeah, but no man wants to lose. I don't know.
A lawsuit brought against him. Coming up on Bloomberg TV,
you're doing
Emily Chang.
Right ahead.
Oh, go ahead. Speaks
no,
to David Kirkpatrick, the CEO of Techonomy. And tomorrow we'll talk with Republican strategist and Kasich delegate wrangler, Mr. Charlie Black. Until then, for me, Batman and the Riddler, and John, sayonara.